Okay. So the first thing you should know is we're from Canada and everything about us is big. And the things we're showing you are important because they affect our programming. Everything affects your programming, right? The climate, the topography, everything affects how we operate. So you can tell our country is bigger than the entire European Union. So we're immense and we're scattered all over the place. It's not for us, often on a typical day, we will drive for 4 hours for a 1 hour meeting. Mm-hmm. And that's just, that's what we have to do. We live in the province of Manitoba. It is located in central Canada and has approximately 1.3 million people. The population of Bulgaria is approximately 7.1 million people. Our province will hold your country six times. And so again, it's a very large place. So just some interesting facts about our province. We have over 100,000 lakes in our province. Fresh water is not a problem for us. In fact, we have so many lakes that in mainstream society, only about 10,000 of them have been named. We've run out of words in our language for our lakes. Although almost all the lakes will have a name from our indigenous people, and we'll talk about that a little later on. We also want to share some demographic information about our province because this is very critical in the work we do. So I mentioned that we have about 1.3 million people in our province, but we speak over 100 languages. So diversity is our power, it's also our challenge, right? Because we have to learn to live together. After English, the second most spoken language in our province is Tagalog, which is Filipino. Per capita, we have the largest Filipino community in North America. We also have the largest Icelandic community outside of Iceland. So we have many countries make us their second home. We have in our province the second lowest population of people who are Caucasian. And in fact, we will be the first province where people who are Caucasian will become the minority. We have seven indigenous people. I'll talk to you a little bit about them because they're central to the work that we do in our economy and our social life. We have seven different indigenous people. Some of you may hear the term Indian. Don't use that word. Even Native American. It's not appropriate in our country. We don't use that. We use the global term indigenous, which means anyone that has any indigenous DNA. Okay? But people who view themselves as being entirely indigenous, 100%, are referred to as First Nation people, the first people. And we have seven first peoples. Each has its own culture and its own language. The indigenous community in Manitoba is very large. It represents about 18% of our population, but most importantly, between the ages of 18 and 29, it actually represents 30% of our population. It's enormous. It's our future. The birth rate in the indigenous community is about four times the average for Canada. Also, they have, unfortunately, above average representation in all the worst social indicators: death, incarceration, illness. Right? But they make up a huge percentage of our population. This is a result of the damage done by colonization when Europeans came to our country. Most people think, when you mention Canada, we're big and we're cold. It's true. We are cold. And so we have beautiful summers. Our average temperature is somewhere between 23 to 29 Celsius every day. It's dry, but most of the time it's cold. So we were talking to our families just the other day, and with the wind it was minus 30 Celsius. Mm-hmm. And winter hasn't officially started yet, so. Our capital city is Winnipeg. It holds 55% of the population of our province. It's important to recognize in a province that has six times the size of Bulgaria, outside of the city, there are only about 630,000 people in the rest of it. Right? For you, that will seem very empty, right? But it presents some unique challenges for us in terms of our success that we'll talk about. So now, I want to tell you a little bit about Career Trek, now that you have some context. Oh, before I do that, I also want to point out, because of course most of you here are educators, just quickly some differences in our education system. Like you, we have a system that is kindergarten to grade 12. That's our secondary system. We do not have the test that you have in grade 7. Okay? For your post-secondary system, my understanding is you have university. We have three options. We have university, which is for four-year degree programs, college, which is two-year diploma programs, and vocational. So vocations are on the same level as university. Okay. So, first I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself and why I started Career Trek. But while I'm telling you my story, I actually would like you to think about your story. I want you to think about the journey that you made, and maybe for many of you, the journey that your children are trying to make right now, or your relatives, or when you were younger, perhaps, your friends and your classmates. So, I didn't understand why school was important. I loved school. I never missed a day of school. But I really had no idea what bearing it had on my life. I didn't understand what value any of my subjects had. I knew what I liked and what I didn't like, but I still didn't understand what difference it would make if I learned it or didn't learn it. My parents did not have post-secondary education, although I had loving, supportive parents who thought education was important, but they had no information, and they had no firsthand knowledge themselves. My father had grade 7. He was working. Class man, my mother stayed at home. There was no money for my education. My studies, my academics were weak. When I was young, I was struck by a disease and I lost the ability to walk. And so I lived for about 2.5 years in a hospital. And during that time, I received very little schooling. So the rest of my life, once I learned to walk again, I was playing catch up. And my grades were very low. But because my grades were low, many people equated that with my intelligence. And so terms like Darrell going to university or Darrell going to college never came up. People equated my grades with my intellect and my future possibilities. And what was forgotten during that time was that I was just a young person trying to survive in the world, like every other young person, right? So of course you're trying to deal with changes in your body, getting a driver's license, looking good to the ladies in my case, and failing miserably. All of those things that young people have to do and still perform well in school, they're all very challenging, right? And the result was that I failed school. And I was completely lost. So I got a job in a very low-end retail situation where the employees were treated very badly. And one day I remember the manager talking to an employee and yelling at her and making her cry. And I couldn't understand why he would do that and why she would take it. And later I realized why. Because she was a young single mother and she had no options. She had to take it. And I realized that would be the rest of my life if I didn't get an education. So I had to get an education. So I finished high school, and then I went to college, and I failed college because I went into something I didn't know who I was, what I was good at, so I just picked something and I failed miserably in that field. Eventually I figured it out and I went to graduate school, long story short. So I wanted to, as a result of my experience, develop a program so that no child would go through what I went through, and that no parents would go through what I went through. Right? That they were empowered to work with the education system and the community to have a fuller, richer experience and allow people to actually experience how...
...на хората да узнаят колко важно е образованието за тях и да се възползват от тези знания. И така разработихме една програма, която според нас трябваше да постигне няколко цели. На първо място да даде възможност на младите хора да завършат образование над средното и да разберат, че това е важно. Искахме те да развият у себе си уменията и компетенциите, които ще им бъдат полезни.
To provide a connection between the subjects the children are learning in school and future life opportunities, because those things aren't obvious to children when they're sitting in your classrooms, are they? We wanted them to have a better understanding of themselves. And we wanted to help do more to bring families together. I know many of you will ask us today probably about how we work with parents, and we're delighted to share that. But of course, we know that who's the most important influence in their life? The family. So what can we do with the family? So some of the key elements in our program are that we wanted to have children develop essential skills. We wanted their education, we wanted them to understand how their education was relevant to their lives. We use career development as our primary vehicle for engaging young people. We think that career development is greatly underutilized, and when we use that, it's a way of showing children in very tangible ways what school does for them. We start early, and I'll elaborate on that soon. And we're holistic. So you've all heard the expression, it takes a village to raise a child. That's true. Everyone in the village is an educator. Some people are teachers in schools, but still everybody else in your community is an educator. And if a child's going to succeed, it's important that the entire community is behind that child, because there is no community without children. So we decided we would start in the middle years, grades 5 and 6. Why do we start in grades 5 and 6? Well, first of all, we know from research that this is the age that children are most likely to explore possibilities. So they're very open to learning new things, taking chances, and reaching out. So this is the age that we wanted to engage them. We also know that this is the time that they're forming their horizons, especially around career possibilities, not around specific paths they'll take, just generally how far they can go. So another reason for doing it. We also wanted to involve their families. So perhaps it's different in Bulgaria, but for us, you never want to work with teenagers if you want the parents to be involved, because of course the children want nothing to do with their parents. So we knew that if we wanted to have parents involved, we had to start when the children were much younger. Right? We also wanted to be in a situation where children could learn these things, the lessons we were trying to teach them, before they picked their high school courses. In Canada, when children get to grade 9, they start to select and have
обучение за бъдеще. При нас, 9-ти клас, учениците избират бъдещето си образование, курсовете за бъдещето образование, на тази възраст, но причините, поради които те избират определени курсове, са най-различни, с изключение на знанията. А ние искахме да им обясним колко важно е да се взема това решение на базата на знанията.
So we've provided you with some philosophical background for this right now. So what I'll do now is I'll ask Lasha to come up, mm-hmm. and she will start to explain how our programs work.
Great. Good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk about the Wonder of Work program to start with, and that's our entry-level program. And we offer that program in all four regions of the province. And we bring young people to all of our major post-secondary institutions in the province to experience hands-on programming and experiential learning of different occupations that are available at those post-secondary institutions. The lessons that we have for the children are all very realistic in nature, because we want the children to be able to envision themselves in that occupation one day. So it's really important that the lessons that we have the kids participate in are very real to that occupation. In areas that have limited access to post-secondary institutions and that sort of space, it becomes all the more important for community to be involved in providing those sorts of sites and those learning facilities so young people can be exposed to different post-secondary spaces as well as occupations that might be available at those particular institutions. So NGOs, government, business, all of those community groups can become involved in the provision of those facility spaces for such programming. And given the facts are indisputable globally, actually, that people within education are provided with more options for their future, it becomes that more important for us to be able to expose young people to post-secondary options. And right now, across Manitoba, we are working with 134 schools. We're working with 22 school divisions, 8 post-secondary institutions, 40 post-secondary departments and faculties, and 800 kids come through our program every year. And we work really, really closely, you know, with our community to be able to provide programming such as the program I'm about to elaborate on in one moment, but we work really closely with all of our partners to be able to have this in place, Career Trek in place. Mm-hmm. So how does it work? How does Career Trek work? We work very, very closely with all of our schools to be able to select students.
Берем учениците, които да участват в програмата Чудесата на професията и в останалите програми. Учителите и директорите и хората, с които работим в училището, подбират учениците въз основа на определени критерии, които им задаваме. Критериите са примерно за подбор на участниците. Кои ученици са ще постигнат най-голям успех в програма на Career Track? Кои ученици ще имат най-голяма възможност да са успешни и да завършат програмата? Понякога подбираме ученици, които имат нужда от това леко побутване от страна на програмата, за да успеят в живота и в училище. Също така, подборът се извършва и с участието на родителите по време на една сесия за ориентиране. Ние обясняваме на семействата каква ще бъде тяхната роля в програмата, за да постигне детето им успех. Обясняваме каква е ролята на училището по отношение на подкрепата за учениците. И много често говорим и с самите ученици, за да сме сигурни, че те ще разбират каква е тяхната роля в програмата, какви ще са очакванията им, че трябва да инвестират време, усилия и така нататък по време на програмата. Има такса от $25 на семейство за участие в програмата, за цялата продължителност на програмата. Това е нещо, което се очаква семейството да заплати. По време на ориентацията в училище всички бъдещи участници подписват договор, споразумение. Това е нещо, което, така да се каже, запечатва сделката. В договора са описани клаузи, с които семействата и децата също се ангажират да бъдат пълноценни участници, както и училищата. Трябва да идват всеки път на заниманията в програмата. Семействата също поемат някакви ангажименти. И наистина, по отношение на професиите, които те опитват, те наистина участват активно. Целта е да се предприеме едно пътешествие, в което децата да открият какво им харесва, какво не им харесва, коя професия ги привлича и така нататък. Трябва също да споменем, че в някои случаи имаме семейства, които живеят в много трудни условия и не могат да си позволят таксата. Когато това се случи, семейството допринася с някакви неща, които имат емоционална стойност. Примерно, семейства носят различни семейни албуми, любими играчки на децата. Тоест, опитваме се не във всеки случай да направим пари от това.
A stake in it. And they do that by risking something.
Right. So in terms of the program structure, like the actual framework of Career Trek, in Winnipeg, for example, in the Winnipeg region, we run 20 weeks of Wonder of Work. So children get to experience 80 different occupations over the course of that 20-week period, and they attend programming on Saturdays. So the idea is that they're not missing school, and their learning takes place outside of those hours. But of course, we all know, being educators, that learning happens all the time. It's not just in school. It happens on the weekends. It happens at home. It happens when they're out playing with their friends. So learning is an ongoing thing. The kids that come to our program get to experience 18 different academic fields over the course of that 20-week period. And they get to visit 4 different campuses. So they get to go to 2 university campuses and 1 college campus. And they spend 5 weeks at each of those campuses to learn more about what types of education streams are available at those particular institutions so they can start beginning their plan for their future beyond grade 12 graduation. It's really important, a really important component of our programming at Career Trek is that we mix the students up. So we've got kids, we've got rural students coming in to Winnipeg, and we also have a large component of kids from our urban center also attending the program, and they're all coming together on a Saturday to participate. So the idea is that we would be mixing rural students with kids from urban settings, mixing, you know, students that might be coming from Indigenous communities with kids from Winnipeg. You know, we have a high number of newcomer families that attend our programming too. So having them all together and providing them with a platform to be able to learn from one another and to be able to share information about their culture, their community is a really, really, it's a really, really good thing for them to be able to bring into their, you know, into their future education and career. So we feel that that's a really important component. And then when we talk about looking at differences and embracing difference, when we look at, like Darrell mentioned, we have 100 different languages in Manitoba. Like that's pretty diverse, right? So these kids are given an opportunity to embrace that diversity while they're at Career Trek and, you know, be able to function in that capacity because it's an important piece, especially if you want to be successful in life, considering that. So we have
имаме екип за разработване на учебната програма, който разработва всички наши уроци. В програмата Чудесата на професията споменах, че децата се докосват до 80 различни професии, така че нашия екип, който разработва учебната програма, е наистина много активен. Учебната програма е ключов елемент, защото позволява на педагозите да говорят с децата по отношение на тяхната пътна карта. Ако детето иска да се занимава с дадена професия в бъдеще, е важно то да разбере защо математиката е важна или английският е важен. Затова и в 5-6 клас е необходимо да се обясни на детето, че ако иска тази професия някой ден да е неговата професия, задължително трябва да разбира математиката. Тогава детето прави връзката и осъзнава защо математиката като предмет е важен елемент от бъдещата му професия, която харесва. Цялата ни учебна програма позволява на учениците да подбират своите курсове в гимназията. Много ученици подбират курсове в гимназията, както каза Даръл, без изобщо това да се основава на информирано решение. Така че с нашите уроци, които са част от учебната програма, целим те да вземат информирано решение в 9-ти клас. Когато показваме как функционират различните професии на децата през тези 20 седмици, полагаме много усилия да посочим взаимната връзка между учебните предмети и професиите. Искаме да покажем и как отделните професионалисти работят заедно в рамките на една общност. Например, в областта на изкуствата, на кулинарното изкуство, ние показваме на децата как работи даден главен готвач, който примерно е пицар. Също така, по отношение на отглеждането на растения, въобще агрономство или нещо подобно, ние показваме как се отглеждат различните билки, как се разграничават. И по този начин, чрез съответния професионалист, който демонстрира това, ние демонстрираме на децата каква е взаимовръзката между различните хора, които работят в екип. Цялата ни учебна програма се разработва съвместно с партньорите ни от висшето образование, образованието след средното. Това са колеги от университети и колежи, които съставят нашите уроци и които отговарят на съответните стандарти. Те получават одобрение съгласно законите ни в образованието. Едно интересно нещо, което искам да споделя с вас е, извършваме едно проучване преди и след програмата относно нагласите на децата. Най-малко желаните професии от децата са всъщност педагози, учители в класна стая. В края на програмата обаче топ изборът на децата е да бъдат педагози, да бъдат учители в класна стая, което е страхотно. Причината за това е, че през тези 5 седмици, всеки ден, те са се опитали да бъдат различен вид педагог, образовател. Преди това представата им е била, че педагога е човек, който казва: оправи си чина, не дей да се разсейваш и така нататък. А след това те разбират, че тази професия означава нещо много повече, много по-открито. Открит е процесът. Основава се на обратна връзка, на участие на учениците в час. И всичко това е много вдъхновяващо. Нашите уроци също така засягат темата за това къде учениците могат да продължат образованието си след гимназията. Те приключват програмата с добър поглед за относно това как да продължат своето образователно развитие. така че те се прибират в къщи с материали и с впечатления, които могат да споделят с родителите си и да обмислят бъдещите си решения. Много важна част от нашата учебна програма е да гарантираме, че учениците разбират как да дадат принос на общността със своята професия. Как можеш да допринесеш в общността, ако си учител, примерно, някой ден? Така че ние правим такива обсъждания и това е част от уроците ни. Смятаме, че това е доста важна част от модела ни на програма. Искаме децата да могат да развият силна платформа на ценности, за да може след това да я привнесат в своята общност. Много е важно и трябва да се разбере, че за нас е важно не само децата да получат образование, но и да имат яснота по отношение на бъдещата си професия. По този начин им даваме някакви ценности и те стават хора, които имат необходимите умения. Всичко, което Лаша спомена, е свързано с това не какво отношение има всичко това към теб самия, а с какво може да допринесеш към съответната общност. И да, наистина, за да продължа мисълта на Дарал, ние наистина се надяваме да подпомогнем младите хора
into their future occupation, but really, more importantly, we're hoping that our program is supporting kids so they can transition successfully into their lives, right? Because if you can do that, then you can pretty much do anything. So there are some supports that we require to be able to have a successful outcome at Career Trek, and one of them is transportation. So we provide busing for all of our students because there's a lot of students that could potentially be a barrier. So we definitely make sure that that's all in place and we take care of all of that. We also have an education savings program as part of our support for our families that we work with. It's really important that our families understand that we are there to help them begin to plan for their child's education. So once you have a family has a conversation with one of us about the steps and the steps that it takes to actually put a plan together to start saving for their child's education, all of a sudden post-secondary seems possible, right? But if you don't have those conversations and you don't start that development piece, then sometimes it's kind of like, it seems like it's daunting, and it seems that the financial end of it could stop everything from moving forward. So we don't want that to be a barrier. So we have that in place to be able to support families and being able to plan for that piece of their child's success.
Yeah. So just two things. One is, Lasha mentioned briefly that we provide transportation for all the young people to go to our program. There's no cost. We run dozens of bus routes around our province to pick up all the kids. The kids go to the program on Saturdays. The schools are closed. So the children go to their school and wait for the bus. The bulk of our programming runs in the winter. We don't cancel our program unless it hits minus 40 Celsius. So if it's minus 32 Celsius, we expect the children to be standing outside on a Saturday morning waiting for their bus, right? Mm-hmm. So we have very high graduation rates. So on that basis alone, it tells you how hungry children are to learn and to do something with their lives, right? Mm-hmm. The other thing we want to mention around the education savings piece is that we struggle in Canada because of our particular values to understand why low-income families don't save for their child's education. And I don't know how that compares to the Bulgarian situation or how the funding works. But we are of the belief that if the only issue is that everyone believes that education is important, they value it, and if they aren't going to save for it, it's because they don't have enough understanding and they don't have money. So if you just give people money, they'll go to school. And that has been disastrous. It doesn't work. And the reason is because we don't do this sort of engagement. I didn't know what a university was. It could have been free, and I wouldn't have gone, right? If families don't understand, if they have misunderstandings about that you need, in our province, we focus on accessibility. We want everyone to have an education. But many families think that their children must have an A average in order to go to school. That's just incorrect. But if the parents don't understand this, these are the mistakes that are made. So we really have to engage people emotionally and deal with a lot of those issues before they worry about saving for their education.
Mm-hmm. And as I mentioned earlier, all of our programming is very hands-on. So the kids, when we introduce a lesson, the kids aren't listening like you're listening to me right now. They are actually in that occupation, and they're doing something that person in that occupation would actually be doing in real life. So we're keeping it very realistic, and we're using equipment that a person in that occupation would be using in real life, and we want the kids to get the best experience possible in terms of making a decision about that particular occupation in their future. And with that, we also offer families an opportunity to do just what I've described. And we have family days that run here and there over the course of a year within each of our programs. And the kids can invite however many people they want. So families are sometimes teachers. Families are sometimes grandparents. Families are sometimes neighbors. Whoever a child deems is their family, they can bring to the program, as long as they're 18, as long as they're adults. And the family members get to participate with the kids over the course of those particular days, and they also get to participate in a financial literacy workshop on those particular days, too, to talk a little bit about planning for their child's future education. It's a really great opportunity. I mean, we're talking a lot about the benefits of the program for our kids, but I mean, the benefits are also for the families that attend our program and are touched by our program as well. We've had many family members that have come to our program on a family day and have actually changed their careers because of participating and experiencing an occupation that just lit their fire. Right? So when that happens, we know that the reach goes beyond the participants and that our program is touching others as well, which happens indirectly, but it's quite exciting to see when that actually happens.
We all know that the most powerful force for a child's future is going to be their family. Unfortunately, one of the things that we do is we spend a lot of time teaching children, but we don't spend any time teaching the parents, right? And we rely on the fact that we think that parents already know what their kids know. But we know increasingly that's not true. The world is changing so rapidly, and many parents are feeling left behind. So one day I was at a school orientation, and I asked all the families there, has this ever happened to you? Your child is in grade 5 or 6, and they come home with their homework, and they say, Mom, Dad, what does this mean? And you don't know. Be honest. Every single hand went up, grade 5 and 6. So parents love their children. They're trying to support their children. But in today's world, they're also struggling mightily to try to provide good guidance for their children. And so many times, even when it's well-intentioned, they give their children advice that perhaps isn't as current as applicable as it used to be. Mm-hmm.
At the end of each of our programs, we have a big celebration, and it's a graduation convocation, actually. And so the kids, you know, are actually wearing graduation. It's the whole deal. It's the real deal. And they're wearing graduation gowns, and they get diplomas, and it's just packed. It's just a packed house. It's like this. And the kids have, you know, their families are there. We've got our school partners there, our post-secondary partners, government, our funders, business, and everyone just comes together from the community to be able to celebrate these young people and celebrate their accomplishments over the course of 20 weeks. And when you talk about a little person in grade 5 and 6 coming to the program for 20 Saturdays, minus 40 sometimes, it's a pretty big deal, and it's a pretty important for us to be able to celebrate that, and it's a pretty exciting day, and you can see the parents sitting there in the audience and how proud they are of their children, and it's just the beginning. So it's a really special day for us at Career Trek. Our junior staff mentorship program is part of our development model. And so beyond our Wonder of Work program, we have our next phase of our development model, which is called our junior staff mentorship program. Kids in grade 10, 11, and 12 are invited to come back to the program and participate as junior staff in a mentorship capacity. And what is really awesome about this particular program is that we have presented these young people with an opportunity to be role models and mentors to our younger participants. And, you know, give back to the program as they once were participants, right? So they have all graduated from the program, and they have that former knowledge and ability to be able to support our younger participants in a mentorship capacity, and also revisit some occupations again. And at the end of it, they get a volunteer credit. So they're volunteering, but they get a high school credit for it. So it all gets funneled back into their high school credit system. So it's a really great opportunity for these young people. You know, when we talk about high school students and you know, the importance that we place on giving these young people opportunities to be role models in their community and to be, you know, in situations where they can mentor younger people, Career Trek provides those opportunities to those high school students. In most of our urban schools, most high schools are grade 9 to 12, so they're robbed of that opportunity to be role models to younger students and to be able to have conversations and mentor younger kids. So it's really important that we recognize that, and Career Trek has kind of tapped into that and provided them with that opportunity. And it's a pretty big deal to someone in grade 10 to be able to be in that leadership type role and develop from there. So staffing, all of the staff that we hire are all post-secondary students. So they're all attending university or college. We hire about 200 students a year. So we're big employers on campus. We are interested in being able to support students as they complete their post-secondary education by providing them with employment opportunities. So we do a lot of recruitment and work closely with the universities and colleges to be able to do that. When we hire students, why do we hire post-secondary students? We hire them because A, they're generally younger, not always, but for the most part they're younger, so they're really able to relate well to our younger participants, and they're cool. Like they're kind of, the kids think they're pretty cool. They're students at the university, they're studying in areas that our participants might be interested in. Generally, the students are super passionate about what they're studying at school, and they're able to talk to our participants about their field of study and generate some excitement. And you know, we can actually afford to pay them and hire them as a not-for-profit. So it really works well for us, and a lot of the staff that we have employed are actually past program participants. So right now we have about 60% of the 200 staff that we hire have gone through the program. So they're able, again, to bring a wealth of information, you know, to the program based on their previous experience. And when we talk about the students, they're all future professionals, right? So they're all going to be in the workforce one day. And when we talk about at Career Trek things like social responsibility, and we talk about things like, you know, how can you contribute in your community? How do you grow in your community and support young people? All those sorts of things, because they're future professionals and they're at Career Trek, they're bringing that back into their community and they become seeds for change in their own community. So we're able to touch our part-time staff via our programming as well, which is a really important piece as well. Our M program is a program for young mums, and we have between 15 and 16 young mums that attend our program with their babies for 20 weeks. So they're all high school students, and so they go to school all day, and then they come to Career Trek Tuesday and Thursday nights with their babies. We provide busing for the women and their babies. So it's a special bus that has car seats in it, and we pick them up at their high schools and we bring them to the program, and then we provide them with dinner. And after we eat dinner together, we have a child care team that we've hired and trained, and they take the babies, and the women get to go and learn about their future and start planning for their future by way of engaging in different career lessons as well as skill development workshops. So the M program is a little bit different because it's a balanced combination of career education but also skill development. So we felt that there was a need for more of an equal balance there with that particular cohort of participants.
So one of the things that we do in our program is we do career exploration one night of the week. The other night of the week, we do skill development. So this is just one example of something we do. So we take the young women, and in this particular night, they take a one-hour class on networking. What is networking? Why is networking important? And in fact, I often tell them the story of Eva and Darrell meeting each other and what that sort of event can lead to when people get together and talk. Mm-hmm. And then we have a beautiful room with soft jazz and food, and the young women come into the room, and in there, there are a number of professionals waiting for them. And the young women immediately go in and have to start networking with total strangers, right? Mm-hmm. Many young women feel that they're being judged and not accepted by society, so this is a way for them to speak up and know that they're valued right away. And we do this constantly, all sorts of different things.
Mm-hmm. Our M program, again, we have a graduation at the end of the program, and it's this is a picture of our group this year. So there's all the mums and the babies and the childcare team and the staff and the whole group at the University of Winnipeg. And we offer scholarships for some of the women that go through the program. We also offer a scholarship for one mother's child. So at the graduation ceremony, we have we award a $1,000 scholarship to a parent to be able to start planning for their baby's post-secondary education. So it's a big deal, and it gets them kind of on the right track and start moving forward in terms of that planning. So it's a really, it's a big award at our convocation. And all of the babies that are at the program are all invited back to the Wonder of Work program when they're in grade 5 and 6. So they get automatic entry into the program because their moms actually went through the program. So it's a really, it's a great added bonus, if you will.
So we do a lot of programming with Indigenous peoples. So in Canada, we have particular communities called reservations. When land was taken from First Nation people and they were located on special reservations, which are parcels of land where they live. Typically these are, to say they're substandard living situations would be an understatement. So we do a lot of programming in these areas. It's very challenging. You have to understand that school in Canada was actually used as an instrument for cultural genocide. So to say that historically Indigenous people are not excited about going to school would be an understatement, right? So the question is, how do we help people get an education so they can flourish in mainstream society? But at the same time, how do we respect the values, the traditions, the culture that make them unique so they have an equal place in society? When we started this program, the philosophy we used was called second contact.
Първият контакт между бялата раса и коренното население не се получи много добре. Затова започваме отново с втори контакт. Ако имахме достатъчно време днес цяла сутрин, можех да говоря по тази програма, но нямаме такава възможност, затова ще кажа, че предоставяме подкрепата, която предоставяме по другите програми, но имаме и някои допълнителни неща. Научих някои повече неща за ромите. Там има по-различна история в миналото на много от резултатите са същите и могат да се сравнят. Тоест нещата, както стоят при нас и при вас. Много е важно да постигнем добър успех при работа с коренното население, но за да стане това, трябва да ги третираме като равни, като равнопоставени на нас. Трябва да се научим да ходим и в двата свята, за да сме успешни. Ние смятахме, че те трябва да се научат да ходят в нашия свят, за да бъдат успешни. Но сега смятам, че ние трябва да се научим да ходим, да се движим в тяхния свят, за да сме успешни. Началото ме нарекоха, че се казвам Дерек Кел, но моето друго име, той произнесе едно име на коренен език. Когато шофирахме онзи ден и посетихме едно училище, видях един ястреб. Всъщност това е, той ми е роднина, защото аз принадлежа към клана на ястребите. За мен, за моят син, за моят дъщеря е важно да имаме право да решим кой път да поемем. В тези общности на коренното население общността решава какво ще стане със съответното дете. Значи наблюдава се съответното дете и се взема решение какво ще бъде ролята им в тези общности. На мен ми дадоха съответната роля, когато се запознах с общността. На мен не ми беше нужна тази роля, но трябваше да проявя уважение към техните традиции. Затова поех тази роля. Това е, което трябва да направим, да се държим по правилния начин, когато работим с хората от коренното население. С програмата, която спомена Лаша, я прилагаме спрямо коренното население, но по по-различен начин. Те често нямат чиста вода. Представете си да има една провинция, в която има над 100 хиляди езера, и да има общности, които нямат чиста питейна вода. Ние започнахме да им помагаме да се здобият с чиста питейна вода. Започнахме да разговаряме с тези хора за това какво е станало в миналото и защо има вреди от тези дейности в миналото. Първата година от нашата програма, когато завършихме първата година от нашата програма, ние удвоихме посещаването на училището от децата. Това беше много важно за общността и ние бяхме много горди от постигнатото. Разбира се, има редица предизвикателства в нашата програма. Ние използваме 200 студенти в нашата програма като частично заети. Ние трябва да ангажираме семействата с 800 участника. Има доста родители, които се опитваме да приобщим. И мога да ви кажа, че когато някое дете се провали и не завърши програмата, в почти всички случаи това е по вина на родителите, а не на децата. Също така гимназиите и бизнесът не работят много добре заедно. Опитваме се да хвърлим мост между тези две общности. Разбира се, общността на бизнесмените има нужда от квалифицирана работна ръка, но те ги искат вече готови, подготвени, не желаят да се включат в подготвянето им. Участват в нашите програми и ги подготвят младите хора, разказват на младите хора какви са основите на тяхната дейност. Така тези млади хора, ако изберат съответният бизнес, след това те са много подходящи за съответната работа. Разбира се, и ние, както организацията на ИВА, имаме предизвикателства, свързани с финансирането, но се опитваме да постигнем, да направим най-доброто в това отношение. Знаем, че нашата програма постига големи успехи в краткосрочен план. Това разбираме от нашите проучвания, от резултатите на учениците в края на програмата и знаем, че учениците, че интересът на учениците към училището се увеличава. Също така знаем, че тези ученици поемат ролята на лидери в училище. Когато ние не работим с учениците след завършването на нашата програма и това понякога води до отрицателни резултати, в смисъл, че някои от учениците отпадат от училище. Когато работим с родителите, много от тези родители започват да преосмислят своя професионален път. Затова сега водим преговори с нашето правителство да се започне работа с възрастни. Опитваме се да предлагаме програми на фирмите, за да могат и те също да спомогнат за ориентацията на младите хора. Опитваме се да внедрим програми, основани на училището. Започнахме с извънучебната дейност, за да обясним, да покажем, че обучението е навсякъде. Но искаме сега нашата програма да се вгради в училище. Започнахме първата програма в Канада, която студентите първа и втора година преминават курс по професионална ориентация, макар че вече са в университета, защото те все още са объркани. Използваме всички социални медии и бихме искали да ви благодарим днес за вашето внимание, за времето, което ни отделихте. Бихме искали да благодарим и на преводачите, и на техническият екип за тяхната помощ. Искаме да ви благодарим за това, че в съботен ден, подобно нашите деца, вие сте отделили време, за да дойдете тук и да бъдете с нас. Искам да благодаря и на Центъра за преобщаващо образование. Тяхната дейност ни вдъхновява много. Ние съзнаваме, че между вас и добрата работа, която като се имат предвид вашата добра работа и тяхната добра работа, бъдещето на вашите деца е в добри ръце. Благодарим ви.
Време е за въпроси и отговори. Благодаря на Лаша и Дарел. Докато те си излагат хедсетовете, за да могат да чуват вашите въпроси, сред вас има колеги с микрофони, така че с вдигане на ръка, моля, индикирайте вашето желание да зададете въпрос. Моля, задавайте кратки, точни и ясни въпроси, за да може да включим възможно най-много хора. Кой иска да зададе първият въпрос към Лаша и Дарел? Изчакайте само да си сложат хедсетовете.
We have to answer, right? So how do we do both? We just listen.
Can we just put this like this?
Thank you.
Заповядайте, зададете по своя първи въпрос. Моля,
задам и на английски. Как е по-удобно за тях?
Задайте го на български.
На български.
Да.
Всъщност аз имам два кратки въпроса. Първият, как започнахте и как се финансирате? Тоест, откъде идва вашето финансиране? Дали е, така имате подкрепа от държавата или по друг начин? И втория ми въпрос е как си взаимодействате конкретно с училищата? Програмата, така по някакъв начин, какви са стимулите и за самите училища те да включват деца във вашата програма?
Благодаря.
Okay. Thank you. So, to answer your first question, how did it start? By begging. Like any good NGO. Right now, it took us about 12 years to convince government that what we were doing was a paradigm shift. But once they came on, they became a big funder. So now about 65% of our funding comes from our provincial government. The rest of the funding comes from foundation grants, donations, awards, and monies that we generate on our own through doing contracts with school divisions and things like that. Mm-hmm. We're trying to become more and more less reliant on government every day, mm-hmm. because that always makes you vulnerable, right? Do you want to speak to what's interesting?
Sure. Our relationship with our school partners is pretty extensive. We work very, very closely with our school divisions and the schools that we're partnered with. So we're in contact with them all year, like all program year. We work together. The idea is that it's a very collaborative support system that we provide to our young people. So we're working together to be able to support a child's success at Career Trek. So it's not just our staff. We're working really closely with the schools because we can't do it alone. So that's something that is a really important piece of our program model is the community collaboration. In terms of your last piece of the question was, what was that last piece?
The incentive is for schools.
Oh, so the incentive for schools would be that you have more engaged students. So the idea is that when a student goes through Career Trek, they're learning about the relevancy of their school subjects, right, in grade 5 and 6. So they're understanding, why is it important that I'm in school right now? Why do I have to pay attention in class? They're more focused on their studies. You know, there's a lot of research that we've done whereby we notice kids that have gone through Career Trek are more curious and more interested in, you know, learning about different things in the classroom and more engaged with their families at home outside of the classroom in terms of their studies. So I think that would be a grand incentive for schools.
Yeah, the other thing is we put children first, mm-hmm. which schools respect. I know it sounds trite, but lots of people say they put children first, right? Everyone will say they'll put children first, but in actuality, that seldom happens. So one of the things is in Canada, often Many business sectors are dissatisfied with the education system, and they say children aren't learning what we want them to learn. So we want to go into schools and start showing them. But school...
На ранна възраст да им покажем как се ориентират децата. Разбира се, училищата първоначално са скептично настроени. Затова ние сме нещо като брокери. Опитваме се да доближим, да осъществяваме посредничество между децата и фирмите, които искат да наемат качествен персонал и които не са доволни от наличния на трудовия пазар персонал с техните умения и квалификации. Обикновено учителите казват, че в края на програмата децата стават напълно различни.
Фондация Асист, помагащи технологии. Благодаря много за изключително интересната и впечатляваща презентация. Моят въпрос е съвсем кратък. Как работите с деца с увреждания в системата? И имате ли добри примери и практики за деца, които са успели да влязат в висшето образование? Това е въпросът ми.
Благодаря.
Yeah, thank you, Boris.
Благодаря, Борис. Добър въпрос е това. Разчитаме на училищата да пренасочват деца към нашата програма въз основа на определените от нас критерии. Опитът ни показва в годините, че имаме много деца с затруднения в ученето. Обаче много малко деца реално са с физически увреждания. Не знаем защо е така, но много от децата наистина имат с проблеми, да речем, с дефицит на вниманието, дислексия и други проблеми с ученето. Обикновено работим с училището и семейството и гледаме как обикновено училището и семейството модифицират нещата и тогава персонализираме уроците, за да ги адаптираме към индивидуалните потребности на тези деца. Понякога се сблъскваме с ограничения въз основа на обстановката, в която работим. Понякога може да предложим професионален опит в реалистична обстановка. Реалистичната обстановка е много, много полезна за деца, които имат някакви проблеми с ученето. Защото те срещат проблеми в реалната обстановка. По отношение на успеха, който постигаме, имаме бивши деца, които продължават с висшето си образование. Един от нашите служители имаме, който е напълно сляп, който също продължи образованието си. Имаме един ученик, който е с дислексия. Също така един от нашите членове на борда ни е участвал в програмата. Има определен проблем, но след като завърши програмата, така да се каже, избухна и постигна най-добрия си потенциал по отношение на образователната си кариера. Разбира се, работим с хора с най-различни възможности и се опитваме да адаптираме ситуациите. Не знам дали отговорих на въпроса ви. Също така правим обучение на нашия персонал, на нашите студенти, доброволци. И винаги при това обучение наблягаме на този аспект. Когато студентите или учениците в последните класове от гимназията влязат в ролята си на ментори, ние провеждаме такова обучение. Също така трябва да спомена, че разчитаме на семействата да идентифицират децата с някакви увреждания или затруднения. И в течение на годините съм забелязал, че когато се сблъскаме с такова дете и само когато се свържем с семейството, разбираме, че то има някакви проблеми. Може би семействата се страхуват, че ако подадат тази информация, разкрият тази информация на ранен етап, няма да имат успех или нещо, ще спъне тяхното участие.
Благодаря. Кристиан се казвам. Задам на български въпроса. Как, имате ли позиция за българските специализирани училища или специализираните училища в Европа за деца с проблеми, да ги има или да ги няма? Какво е вашето отношение? Специализирани училища за деца с различни специални потребности, увреждания и така нататък. Благодаря.
Благодаря.
Благодаря ви за този въпрос. Не мога да говоря компетентно за ситуацията в България, но мога да ви кажа каква е ситуацията в Канада. Ние нямаме такива училища в Канада. Единственото изключение е в общността на, глухонемите. Те имат такова училище, тази общност, но единствено защото са поискали такова училище. Тази общност в Канада има много силни позиции, много силна култура и искаше собствено училище. В Канада всичко опира до приобщаването. Дали става въпрос за поведенчески проблеми или проблеми с дисциплината, винаги опираме до приобщаването и до въвличане на цялата общност, за да може проблема на конкретното дете да се реши.
Сигнал, че има въпрос.
Благодаря. Давид Кюранов се казвам от Асоциация Родители. Заедно с колеги от още 8 организации водим кампанията Да бъдеш баща в България. Казахте, че работите с майките. В България също по-често майките са въвлечени в образованието на децата. Каква е ситуацията, как работите с бащите?
Най-напред бих искал да спомена, че аз отгледах своите деца като самотен родител. Имаше много малко ресурси за самотните бащи, по-малко отколкото за самотните майки. В нашата програма сме обсъждали този проблем. Понастоящем нямаме програма за бащи. В програмата за майки не включваме партньори. Партньорите на майките. Обсъждали сме този въпрос с майките. Много от младите жени, които са забременели, са били изнасилени или пък са били подложени на насилие. И те са пожелали да участват в програмата без своите партньори. Някои от тях са били на 16 години и техните така наречени партньори са били на 40 години. Така че това ви дава представа за вида група, с която работим. Това не е една типична група от млади хора, а травмирани млади жени. Това е по-различно от случаите, когато говорим за млада жена, която има стабилен партньор. За това би трябвало да има отделна програма. Така че не бива да забравят и за нас. Аз непрекъснато работя и по този въпрос за бащите. Последен въпрос.
Благодаря.
My question is... You said that you intend to continue working with families. In Bulgaria, families are the biggest problem. The school, the business partners, the government help solve the...
Благодаря.
So we all...
Винаги искаме да ангажираме семействата в нашата програма, която е насочена към пътя на детето. Когато децата са малки и участват в нашата програма, родителите, семейството винаги участва в тази програма. Когато детето порасне, родителите имат по-различна роля. Те участват, но не директно. Децата не желаят да участват директно заедно със своите родители на тази възраст. Но сме забелязали, че дори когато децата са по-големи, те много повече са склонни да се включат родителите в програмата. Това е така в случаите, когато родителите им са участвали в нашата програма заедно с тези деца на по-ранна възраст. Но ние знаем, че родителите могат да ни помогнат много. Много зависи от това доколко са заинтересовани, доколко родителите проявяват интерес към участие в нашата програма. При нас казваме следното. Ако имаме един лев дори, и ако чуем, че даден родител казва, ако аз имах тази възможност, когато бях малък или ученик, непременно щях да се възползвам от нея. Знаем тогава, че този човек е подходяща и не бива да мислим за пари. Също така включваме различни членове на семействата в различни части от нашата програма. Например, при програмата Емма имаме родители, които след това се връщат при нас. Те организират работилници с млади жени. Така че връщаме и членовете на семействата обратно в нашата програма и това води до много големи успехи. Ако веднъж се участва в програмата, после допринасяш много за нея. Разбирам, че трябва да спрем до тук, защото е необходимо да се храним, но отвън сме сложили една кутия. Ако запишете името си на лище и го сложите и го пуснете в кутията, а накрая може да получите малки подаръчета за онези от вас, които имат късмет. Благодаря ви.